So today I'll be talking about container design patterns. So first, what's a container? Basically, a container is an abstraction at the application layer. So a container has all your application logic as well as its dependencies, and it can be deployed easily on different computing environments. Before this, you would have only the application logic, and all your requirements would not have been there at one place. With the help of containers, everything is a package now. So today we are going to discuss about single node, multi-container application patterns. What I mean by single node is most of our container orchestration software supports grouping of containers onto a single node. In case of Kubernetes, it's called a pod. There are different kind of patterns in this sector, basically sidecar pattern, ambassador pattern, and adapter pattern. So let's go, what is a sidecar pattern? So let's take an example of an e-commerce application. So there are four services. One is the UI layer. It talks to the product service to get a list of all products that are available to display to the users. Then when a user places an order, it talks to the order service to place an create an order. Order service talks to the payment service to process the payment. So let's take a new requirement that has come. What we want to do is, the new requirement is, we want to push all the logs from each service to a central service called log parser service. This log parser service, it'll parse your logs, it'll store it in a different format, it'll present it. So how can we do this? One way is we can write a script which reads your log file and uploads it to the log parser service at regular intervals. And we can place this script in every service. That's one way of doing it. If we go towards that approach, what could happen? Suppose there is a requirement that basically once you start scaling up your services, you realize that your product service is a bottleneck, because even when people are browsing, there are calls that are happening to the product service. So to make your product service more efficient, what you decide to do is move from Ruby implementation to a Golang implementation. The impact of this is that now you have to, even your log exporter script, you have to write it in Golang so that there's only one single environment in which you're running. The problem with this approach is that as you keep deviating, you have to maintain more versions of the script in different languages. And when you want to make a modifications, you have to do the changes in multiple places and multiple languages. So that's the problem. One of the solution we can take for solving this problem is sidecar pattern. What's a sidecar pattern? This is a sidecar, but it's not a sidecar pattern. So there's a Kubernetes pod. In the pod, we have this application container, which has all the application logic. And then along with this application container, we deploy another container called a sidecar container. The functionality of this sidecar container, the specialty of this setup is that both application and sidecar container can share common resources such as your network, file systems, and other resources, memory, it could be such things. They share these common resources. So how can we solve our problem using this pattern? So we can have our application container, which writes all the logs to the file storage. We can have our sidecar container, which reads all these logs and exports it to the log parser container. The advantage of this approach is that the logic of uploading the logs to log parser is not actually core of your application logic. So it's in a separate container and it can be maintained by a different team. And your application container doesn't need to even bother about what happens to the logs and things like that. Advantages of using this sidecar container. Functionality of the application can be enhanced without tight coupling. That's what we saw. Even without any coupling, we could deploy a sidecar container which actually uploads your logs. Every container has a single responsibility principle. So your application container has a single responsibility of executing your application code, and your sidecar container has a single responsibility of uploading your logs. Even if you're, if anything fails in your sidecar container, the application container will not be affected by this. We can reuse the sidecar container irrespective of the language the application logic is written in. when to use this sidecar pattern, when a feature or service must be co-located on the same host. If you want a service to share the same lifecycle as the main application, but can be updated independently. These are the few scenarios when you should use sidecar pattern, and when you should not use this when your application container is small. In that case, it doesn't make sense of having a sidecar pattern and maintaining another container separately. When your application container is small, you can have it in the same container itself. When the latency between communication of the application container and sidecar container is really important for you. If you want the latency to be near zero, ideally, then you shouldn't be going with this approach. But if it is not such an important thing like uploading log files, the latency doesn't matter for you, there it makes sense to use. When you want to scale the sidecar independently from application container, you shouldn't use this pattern, because in Kubernetes, scaling is done at a pod level and not at a container level. So if at all you go with this pattern, you cannot scale them independently. You have to scale them together. Points to keep in mind during implementation. So you have figured out what's the use of a sidecar pattern. Now you want to keep, you want to make it easy for other people to use it. So it's better to follow these three principles. One is parameterize your containers, create and maintain the API for the container, documentation of the operation of the container. So we'll go one point each. Parameterize the container. So what we should accept parameters for your container. These parameters in our example could be location of your log file or the frequency at which it should upload your log file. So these should be parameters which people can customize so that they can use your container. Create and maintain the API. You have to have a predefined API, and when you're making any changes to this API, you have to be aware of what are the changes, what are the implications of these changes. So there could be two types of effects. One could be breaking changes, one could be non-breaking changes. Breaking changes example would be like, suppose if you renamed your parameter from frequency to time period. So whoever is using your container, they won't be able to, they have to make changes and it'll break until they make these changes, they can't deploy their containers, their pods. Non-breaking changes could be something like you change the units of the time of frequency. So it could be from milliseconds to seconds. People won't even realize that there is a change. It's not going to break anything, but it's not going to behave as per expectations. Document the operation. So to make it easier for other people to understand what your sidecar container does and how to use it, it's better to document like what are the parameters that you should pass, what are the units in which you should pass. The best place to do this would be the Docker file itself. Let's see some other examples. We saw one example of uploading a log file. Let's see other examples where this makes sense to use. Suppose you have a legacy application which is running, which can serve HTTP requests. And due to some reason, you don't want to mess with the code of this legacy application to add support for HTTPS. How you can handle this way is you can deploy your legacy container to serve only in the local host. It'll serve requests from the local host itself. And then you can deploy a Nginx sidecar, which acts as a proxy for your HTTPS requests from the external world to the HTTP request inside the container. So because these HTTP requests are inside your container, these are safe, whereas all your external requests are still in HTTPS. Another example we could take is, suppose for some reason we want to always have the latest code running on production without even doing any changes. So what we can do is we can have a sidecar container which always queries Git and checks whether it has a latest code. If it doesn't have, it will fetch the latest code and write it to the file storage. Our application controller server could be modified such that it reads all the code dynamically. When our code changes happen, it reads the code changes. This is another example. Any questions before we move on to the next pattern? Yeah. Your Nginx container is the sidecar. Yes, it can be.
This is not end-to-end but yeah. It does work in most cases, in maximum cases.
Yeah, basically you'll see this in legacy application where people don't want to mess with the actual code. They're fine with how it's working. Another use case could be like there is a separate security team. They want to monitor how the data is being encryption of your data when it's going outside and all. They could have a separate container which monitors all your network traffic, make sure that there are encryption. Then you can add trace ID. All such use cases could be implemented using a sidecar container. Okay, moving on to the next topic, next pattern for today. What's ambassador pattern? So here, let's take a scenario of a different application. This is an image sharing application. So here, what services we have is three services: activity feed, image store, and users. So when you log in, this activity feed service talks to the user service to get list of users that you're following. And it then uses that result to query your image store to get images that these users have posted. Let's take a requirement, say Indian government has passed a rule that all the data uploaded by Indians should be there in India only. It shouldn't be outside India. It should be stored within India. How you can implement this is you could shard your database. You can have multiple shards. One of the shard will have only Indian data and it will be present only inside the Indian subcontinent. Sorry, Indian country, I would say. Then what you can do is you can deploy a load balancer so that which reads the incoming request. It has the logic to understand that the request is for an Indian user and direct it to the Indian shard. And if it is for a non-Indian user, it can direct it to the other shards. One problem here is that your load balancer is like a single point of failure and all your traffic is being directed to your load balancer. These are the disadvantages of this. One of the possible solution is your ambassador pattern. What is ambassador pattern? So here what happens is your ambassador container is co-located with your application container and it proxies all the requests that are going to that are being made to an external service. So this monitors, so your application container calls this ambassador container via the local host and your ambassador container calls the external service to process the request. It gets the response and returns it to your application container. And your as per your application container, ambassador container is doing all the processing of your request. So how can we solve this problem with ambassador pattern? We can have a image store ambassador container. This will have the logic of redirecting your request based on the user to the Indian shard or the non-Indian shard. Advantages of this is each and every pod has its own image store ambassador container, so not one pod is getting overloaded with requests. That's one advantage here. Suppose, say, Indian shard is down, your image store ambassador container can still have logic to serve non-Indian content to your users. Advantages of ambassador pattern. It helps in building modular and reusable containers. It makes it easier to build and maintain this ambassador containers. It makes it easier to add features such as circuit breaking, routing, etc. to a legacy application. I'll take another example to explain this point. Features offloaded to the ambassador pattern can be managed or updated independently of the application. When to use this pattern? We should use this when we build a common set of client connectivity features. This could be like, now there are many services that could be talking to your image store service. If you build an image store ambassador service, everyone can just deploy this in their pod and talk to this and don't care about from where it's getting the data, whether the database is sharded or not. All that it doesn't need to bother. Need to support cloud or cluster connectivity requirements in a legacy application, and that's that is difficult to modify. Suppose you want to add circuit breaking feature. I think I'll explain this with an example at a later point. When we want to standardize and extend instrumentation, you can log all the requests that are happening through your ambassador container. Irrespective of whether the application container is logging or not, you can have logic such that your ambassador container does that. When not to use this pattern? Same, when network latency is critical, you shouldn't be using this because it doesn't add a significant lag, but yes, it adds a little lag, and where latency is critical, you don't want to do, everything matters. When client connectivity features are consumed by a single language, if at all a single, all your applications are in a single language like Ruby, it might make more sense to write an Ruby library and deploy it along with the application rather than having a separate container. When connectivity features cannot be generalized, example, retry logic. So you cannot generalize few of the features, and if at all you're generalizing, you should be aware what could be the impact. Let's take retry logic for example. Suppose you have a retry logic that is generalized to a ambassador container, but your external service might not be supporting this retry logic. So when you make a second call, the state of the application of your service state could change. In those cases, it doesn't make sense to use an ambassador pattern. Few other examples where we can use this is like beta testing. Your image store ambassador container can have logic to figure out whether the incoming requests are of beta users or actual users. If they're regular users, it can move direct the request to your production version. If it's for a beta user, it can redirect it to the beta version. Another example is for external service. Suppose payment service is an external service. Say you're using something like Stripe. You can have an ambassador container which is within your control. So you can have the logic of circuit breaking and all implemented in this ambassador container. So it realizes that after making X number of requests, if I'm not getting any response, I won't make any more requests and I'll just return to the application container that the request has failed. Or it could have a retry mechanism. After this amount of time, I'll retry this request. Any other question? Sorry, any questions and answers about ambassador pattern or even sidecar pattern in that sense?
The main difference between sidecar and ambassador pattern is that ambassador pattern is like a making call instead of the application,
yeah,
returning the data.
Yeah, so it acts as a proxy to any external calls. Whereas your sidecar pattern could be like your log parsing service. It's not even, your application service doesn't even need to be aware that there is a sidecar pattern. But whereas for your ambassador, your application controller needs to know that it has to call to the local host. Yeah, that's the thing.
It needs to wait for the resource, like a response from the ambassador
pattern. Yeah. Any other questions? Proxy server. Yeah. So in case of a proxy server example in sidecar pattern, you can't call it as an ambassador pattern because your service doesn't make any external calls. Your sidecar pattern is, your sidecar is actually monitoring your incoming requests. But whereas in ambassador, it's monitoring your external requests. So that's the difference basically in that case. It depends on your use case. It doesn't make sense that you should always go with an external container. It totally depends on your use case whether it makes sense to use. Let's take for example the beta. This beta users might be, it's not something that you do regularly. In that case, once in a blue moon, if you do this, might be it makes sense to have this instead of as an ambassador container as an external service, so that you can just deploy it and then bring it down. So why we can't have this image store logic redirection in application container itself, right? The problem here is one thing could be like your image store logic is being maintained by a separate team which handles image store. That could be one reason. Second reason is that if you have the same logic in application controller, you're sort of coupling it directly with image store, right? Without image store service, it cannot exist because it has the logic of even image store. And it's going to make things complex. Basically, once you go towards microservices pattern, you try to decompose your containers, your services, such a way that one service handles only one part of your logic. So might be this application container, might be this that your feed, activity feed service. So it wants, its responsibility is only just to populate your activity feed. It doesn't care how your images are stored. All that is supposed to be taken care by another microservice called image store service. So that's the reason why you generally don't have it in the same container. Any other questions? Okay. These are few references you can go through. Thank you.